think they should make sure that they. Maybe speak back a little bit. I prefer it to be everyone, but if you specifically have, I mean. And as time allows, we'll. Wants to ask questions independent of what we've prepared, we have forms and we can get those and we'll collect those in probably about a half an hour or so.
Can we collect them in a half hour?
Yes.
Okay. Welcome to the Greater Gebser Neighborhood Association's candidate form. Greater Gebser Neighborhood Association is not endorsing any candidate. It is our intent to allow for an open forum for all candidates to introduce themselves to the community. The Greater Gebser Neighborhood Association is monitoring this forum. The City of Kaiser, the employees, officers, and agents have no connection with the forum. Any concerns with the conduct or rules of this forum should be directed to the Greater Gebser Neighborhood Association. Candidates have drawn a number for the order in which they will respond to the questions. We will go 1 through 6 and then reverse order for the next question. Dylan is 1. Ross 2, Michelle 3, Michael 4, Kyle 5, and Laura 6. Any questions so far? We have a timer. The timer will lift a paddle at 30 seconds left, another paddle at 10 seconds left, and at time out, she will just paddle you. With the one that says thank you. Thank you, Jane. Okay. What we'd like to do now is just, we'll do a quick introduction. Each candidate will briefly introduce themselves, and they will have 1 minute to do that. We will start with Dylan.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you. Thanks to the Greater Kaiser Neighborhood. So I'm Dylan, and I'm running for council position number 2. I've lived in Kaiser my whole life. I grew up here going to Gebser, then Whitaker, and then graduated from McNary in 2009. And I, can you not hear me? I'll just
talk about it. Not off.
It's on. Hello? Is it coming? All right, I'll just talk loud. Sorry, I lost my spot. So I grew up here, I graduated from McNary, and I have served for the last 5 years on the Parks Advisory Board.
served on the City of Kaiser's Planning Commission. I was also appointed by Governor Kitzhaber to serve on the State Capital Planning Commission. For the last 10 years, my oldest child is moderately disabled with cerebral palsy. My wife and I have volunteered extensively in the special needs community, most notably at Camp Attitude. So I want to thank you all for being here and for this opportunity, and I look forward to getting a chance to introduce myself.
All right, good evening. Thank you again to the Greater Webster Area Neighborhood Association. I really appreciate you hosting the candidate forum this evening. My name is Michelle Roland Schwartz, and I'm running for position number 3 for the Kaiser City Council. I am a nonprofit leader, an advocate, and a mom of 3 children that my husband Sam and I are raising in West Kaiser. I am a volunteer for the Cummings PTA, attending a lot of youth events. I'm our Box Tops coordinator. I am the executive director of the Oregon Attorney General Sexual Assault Task Force, which happens to be based in Kaiser. For the last 10 to 12 years, we are right out there on River Road, and enjoy volunteering in the community, both as a reviewer for a Pacific Northwest Foundation that provides scholarships for LGBTQ youth who are interested in attending college, as well as being recently appointed to the Kaiser Arts Commission. And regardless of the outcome of this election, I will continue to serve in our arts community. Thank you again for having me.
Good evening, my name is Mike DeBlasi, and I'm running for position 1 on the Kaiser City Council. Thank you to the Greater Webster Neighborhood Association for inviting us here. This is my home neighborhood association. I've lived in Kaiser since 2012. I moved up here from Southern Oregon. I have degrees in natural resources, and my past jobs have been with state, federal, and tribal agencies. I have a family with 2 children who go to school at Webster Elementary, and you'll hear some more of my what I would like to do as counselor as we go through tonight, but just remember that one of my big things is moving Kaiser forward for the future and for the people moving here that will want Kaiser to be prepared for the future. So thank you.
Good evening, I'm Kyle Turan. I am running for counselor position number 3. I have lived in Kaiser for 24 years, raised my family here. We lived in the Webster neighborhood up until this last year. And I hope to use my experience as a businessman and as a small businessman and having been on the Planning Commission for 6 years, I hope to use that experience in the future as growth in Kaiser is one of our major concerns. I plan to use everything that I've learned in construction and in what I do on my day job to help that. And I plan to use my experience with Kaiser Chamber forward also.
Thank you, Governor Neighborhood. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. My name is Laura Reed, and I am running for re-election for Kaiser City Council Position 1. I've been on the council since 2016, and I'm ready and eager to serve another term, and I appreciate this opportunity. I have been a teacher at McNary High School, an English teacher, since 2001, so this is my 20th year of teaching. And while at McNary, I served in a variety of capacities besides teaching, which things like site council, Islander Club advisor, dance team coach, department head, various task force. I definitely have been very involved in the McNary community. In addition, I serve on the board of the Kaiser Heritage Foundation and the Kaiser Homegrown Theater. And I began my professional life with a bachelor's in public relations from Brigham Young University, and I have a master's in literature, rhetoric, and teaching from Oregon State. And so we were in Corvallis, graduated from here and went to college very prepared for the world and, well, for college and the world. But anyway, it was a wonderful place to raise our children. They are grown now. They live here. Well, my oldest lives here in Kaiser with her two young sons, my grandsons, and they're going to Kaiser Elementary currently. So Kaiser, of all the places we lived, has been the most like, the most home. And I'm really eager to serve my community further. Thank you.
Done different studies on it, and we'll talk about it a little bit. The a smart way that that will help them and benefit the community. So I feel that the everything that's led up to where we are right now with the talking about the urban growth boundary, talking about growth and density and things like that in Kaiser, I believe has really been beneficial to allow us to move forward. And I hope to just be a part of that and build on to what has been accomplished this far. The in the different meetings that we've had, I believe a lot of things have come out that have really been beneficial and have given people something to talk about and something to discuss that has really meant something to the greater community here. So I just hope to be able to move forward with that and to be a part of the future of Kaiser.
So the first thing I would say was the revision to our charter that struck out the anti-LGBTQ language to be on the ballot to vote. If you haven't got your ballot in yet, remember to look at that. But the greatest accomplishment of the current city council, I would say, is the Kaiser revitalization plan. I was on the advisory committee. I was also on the planning commission with Kyle. And talking on the advisory committee, we talked a lot about how restrictive zoning can be to allow for more housing options. There's a thing called the missing middle, triplexes, duplexes, sometimes even fourplexes. You allow more housing options to get more affordable housing and without having to expand our footprint. It's also, as I said, more efficient use of land, but not just from that based mindset, but also from a revenue standpoint. As Laura had mentioned, you have a very low tax rate per thousand. So you have two options. You either raise your taxes, which is hard, or you squeeze more tax revenue per acre. And you can do that with a thing like we did with the Kaiser Revitalization Plan. And it also supports other forms of transportation, so it can get people be able to more freely use walking, biking, and bus service. I'm also on the traffic safety bike committee. And one thing about the revitalization plan, I think it's great that we've done that so far on the River Road and Barta Cherry corridors, but I definitely would like to see that concept expanded throughout the city so we can get more infill and more housing options that people of all economic levels come forward. Thank you.
So there are a number of things that actually kind of ran through my mind as you asked this question of many of the great things that I think that the City Council has put forward. And I think I'll start with when my husband and I moved here, we've been renters our entire life, adult life I should say. And we bought our first home here in Kaiser, and part of the reason that we moved to the area that we did is because of the proximity to parks. The ability to take our kids to Wallace House Park, take a stroll to Sunset, and then to have the big toy as an asset in this town was something that meant a lot to us as parents raising our young children. And so I think just that investment in our park system has been pretty remarkable. I've really appreciated that. I also, just thinking about the pandemic and the response to COVID in the community, I have so appreciated the conversations that I've had with Mayor Clark about how we've reframed that issue in our community, about doing what it is that we need to do, but also being positive about how we move forward. And sorry if I messed up the tagline, but I think it's phase future or phase forward. You know, how do we do what we need to do to kind of take that next step to make sure that all of us are healthy and can support our businesses and do what we need to do to be successful. So I've appreciated the conversations there. I also really appreciate the Charter Review Committee and all the work that went into updating the charter and removing Section 44, the anti-LGBTQ language from the charter. As someone who does sexual and domestic violence work across the state, one of the conversations that we have statewide risk factors for violence, abuse, harassment, etc. And that language is being a risk factor. And the fact that the city has made all of these strides to eliminate that is making a statement, I think, for all residents of our community. And that is the conversation that I would like to be a part of moving forward, is how can we recognize and acknowledge the need for safety and humanity for all residents of our community. And I think for me, that is the thing that has certainly drawn me to the conversations that the city council has had. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to echo the sentiments that my fellow candidates have made here. I agree with what they said, whether it be the charter revision and the removal of Section 44, certainly the dedication and the planning that's gone into the Kaiser Revitalization Plan. But I think the greatest accomplishment that this city council has done, and it's really, it may sound like a broad platitude, but it's God's honest truth, is they've kept Kaiser a great place to live. And these days, that is a very difficult thing to do, if not impossible. If you look at other communities, not only in our state, but across the country, the division, the polarization, obviously we see what's going on up in Portland and in other communities, and the fact that we don't face that same type of polarization and division, that people still want to move to Kaiser and still want to make this their home, that Kaiser still has the neighborhood feel that we all love, is no small accomplishment. And it's something that every member of the city council and Mayor Clark should be commended for these days. There's no question about that in my mind. You look at, as an example, the parks fee and the investment in our city parks, which makes Kaiser, again, a great neighborhood, attracted Michelle and others. That is an amazing accomplishment that cannot be overstated. If I'm fortunate enough to be elected to the city council, I'll do everything I can to continue that tradition. It's not just a tradition that the current city council has started, but it's something that's gone on for 20, 25 years. And I would be honored to be a part of that, and I would appreciate your vote.
Thank you. I have the misfortune of going at the end and having to just repeat what everyone else has said. I think to me, and I'm admittedly, I'm a little biased as I was part of the Parks Board that kind of helped. Ultimately, though, the City Council gets to take full responsibility for the Parks fee. That was super important to me, and I just want to say that the City Council, our council liaison, I think it was mostly Roland through all of that, really encouraged us, you know, that we should continue on that. It was a long process. I don't know, at the risk of sounding boring here, it was a little bit of a long process. We asked people what they wanted and asked them how much they were willing to pay for it. And we heard loud and clear that people just wanted their parks to be functional and safe and maintained. They didn't want them falling apart, which unfortunately they kind of were. And the great work that is gone because of that fee is just all over the place. The skate park has been revitalized. It is amazing. We have put new toys in and repaved all sorts of pathways and sports courts. And all of that is thanks ultimately to the City Council. So that one to me is the most important. But that's just a personal thing. I also want to echo the ideas that we've had about the Charter Review Committee. I think that's number two in my mind, is that the charter that we all end up having to vote for, but City Council is the one who got it there. That's really, really important to me as well. Of course, we can go down the line of great things of the police fee that came around the same time as the parks fee. That's great as well. But again, to me, number one, the parks fee was just really crucial. I use those parks every day, and it means a lot to me as someone who's trying to build a family here. Those parks are going to continue to be used every day, and now I don't have to worry that we just bump them once. We will be able to keep taking care of them for the foreseeable future. So thank you.
I've been granted permission to allow Mayor Clark to also answer that question. Mayor Clark, would you like to come forward and do that?
Right over here is fine, if that's okay.
I have to ask the cameraman.
Yes, that's your good side.
Yeah, it is.
Thank you for letting me jump in at this point. I wasn't sure I was going to be able to be here tonight, so thank you for allowing me to also participate. I don't have an opponent for this race, but I think participating in all of the candidate forums that I can is important because I'm asking people to continue to vote for me in the work that I and the council team have been doing to continue the work of making Kaiser that warm, welcoming place both now and for the future. So some of the things I'm proud of for the last last couple of years, the Parks and Police Fee was a collaborative effort. We had members of the park board who took leadership. Matt Lawyer and Donna Bradley worked hard on putting together the questionnaire that would go out and really engaged our community in what do we want so we could define that and know once we figured out the what, then we could figure out the how. And boy, howdy have we. They are beautiful now and for all of our parks. And our parks serve the entire community. In our last work session, we talked about how important it was that all of our parks are in good shape and welcoming throughout our community. So we don't have and have not parks. We don't have and have not neighborhoods for being served with parks. We want to make sure parks are a place where everyone can be safe and have a great time outdoors. I am very proud also of the Charter Review Committee. Councillor Elizabeth Smith chaired that task force. Council President Freeman served on that with seven other members of our community, and they went through line by line, looking at the entire charter, not just, I'm going to do one or two things and call it good. Oh no, that's not the Kaiser way. The entire thing was reviewed, also with great assistance from our city attorney and his assistant, Tammy Harms. What they brought to council was so thoroughly done, so well thought out, it was very simple for me to say, yes, let's put this on the ballot and ask you to support it. Going forward, I'm so proud that our council is willing to continue to engage in outreach to the community. We want to keep on growing in our ability to make our city a place that welcomes everybody, that engages all of our ideas, because I don't have all the answers, but I know collectively we do, and that's the Kaiser way. Thank you.
Thank you. Our question number two. Again, you will have 3 minutes to answer this.
Can you use the mic? I'm sorry. It comes really good on the live stream. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here, Mr. Dell.
Yes.
Question number two, and you will have 3 minutes to answer. There has been much discussion in our area regarding police departments, and particularly SROs in the schools. Do you feel changes need to be made to the Kaiser Police Department? How would you work to support your ideas?
All right, this one. Really crucial. I'm glad we got to talk about it because general questions about police will go anywhere. You asked about, and I think it's important to mention this, SROs means school resource officers, who are what it sounds like, police officers essentially who work in our schools as a resource for those schools. I think it's important to state that our police here generally are doing a really great job, and we should encourage encourage them to continue to do that great job. Now, obviously, the police fee has allowed them to do even more. School resource officers generally are doing a great job, but when students are saying that they feel unsafe or that they're having a problem, we should believe them, we should listen to them, and work on improving that relationship. I think that we have a lot to do in listening to the community and listening to these students and taking what they have to say and working on that. I don't know what the right answer is. Do we remove them completely? Some people want that. Do we just work to put in place some accountability measures? I think that's probably what I would work on. I think would be important is putting in place measures to ensure that we have fair and safe accountability both for the community that the police serve and the police themselves. I talked about it a while ago at another forum that some of the things that other communities have tried with the police to hold them accountable is to use body cams. And this can be a really great tool to hold police accountable and to keep them safe in the event that someone claims they did something that they didn't. But those body cameras are completely worthless if you don't put a policy in place to make sure that that footage is accessible to the right people at the right time. And so you might as well not have them if you're not going to make sure that you can access that footage when you need to, or to put in place backup measures so that they can't mysteriously turn off at a crucial point. So I don't know if we'll be able to do those things, but I certainly want to have a voice in trying to work towards them. Thank you.
I think there were two questions in that one question, and one was, do changes need to be made to the Kaiser Police Department? And second of all, what do you think about school resource officers? I'm not aware of any issues that we've had. I'm not saying that doesn't mean there aren't any with the Kaiser Police Department. So I think that falls into the old saying that if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I know I'm fortunate enough to know many police officers, and they're fine individuals who love the community and love serving people of Kaiser. So unless somebody brought me a specific instance of either misconduct or questionable behavior or whatever, you know, I'm not prepared here to sit here and say that, yeah, we need to make changes to Kaiser Police Department. I'm gonna provide you a little bit different perspective on school resource officers. My oldest son, as I told you before, moderately involved with cerebral palsy. If you were outside waving us with us today, you saw him in his wheelchair. He went to McNair. He can't defend himself. If something, God forbid, were to happen at McNary, who's going to defend him? Who's going to protect him? That's what school resource officers are there for. Let's make that clear. My son can't speak. He can get around in a wheelchair. He can talk with his hands. He can do a lot of that kind of stuff, but he can't defend himself. The idea that a school resource officer, a police officer, is not in that high school,
working with me and working with others to have those really difficult conversations about what is working and what is not working, because we all want safe communities. And so in terms of what we might do here in Kaiser would be the same conversation that I would have, that we're having in all parts of the state, about what is the relationship in the community with our residents and how can we make that better. In terms of the issue with school resource officers, I think it is very complicated. I mean, we have folks that want them there, obviously, and folks that don't. And my approach would be one that would be a measured approach. I think it's important that we listen to you. And I don't necessarily think that folks value what our young folks have to say, what their experiences are. And I think it's important that when people tell you their experiences, that you believe them, and that we show up and listen, and then identify what is it that we need to do to make sure that everybody is safe in our schools. One other thing that is really important to me is that our young folks have the opportunity to disclose whatever might be happening to them with someone that is safe, with someone that is confidential, so that then they can make a decision about, okay, now I want to talk with a law enforcement, or now I want to talk with a school resource officer. Because I think for many people, whoever might be hurting them might not be someone that they want to get in trouble. And that is a really scary decision to make. And so it's important that for our young people, that we have lots of different options available to them so that they can then make a decision about what they want to do. And so those are the conversations that I would want to be involved in, and my perspective and background working with law enforcement, not just in Oregon, but in other states, to really identify what are the issues and how to make them better.
Perfect timing.
Thank you. It is true this is a very contentious issue, depending on what community you come from. So I think one of the things that we can talk about is to improve our police force here would be making sure that they get good bias training. Humans were hardwired to, one, see things through our own eyes, and to associate ourselves with a certain tribe, and that means we don't always see things from other perspectives. So bias training would be really important. Another thing would be to make sure that we hire police that match the demographics of our community, so when people interact with them, that they can see themselves in that police officer. I do think that generally Kaiser Police do a good job. Now, as to the SROs, again, I think we should focus on the resource part of that name. There's an important need for those individuals in our schools, but sometimes someone who comes to a situation that looks like a cop, is dressed like a cop, that might not de-escalate the situation. So we focus on having people there that are resources for the staff as well as the students, and not being
some of the things that have gone on and how well the police department over the years has worked to be there for the community and to do their very best. I'm sure that there's times when they could have done better, but I believe their overall concept and experience that they have is to do the best for the community. One of the big things I see across the nation is respect. The people don't respect the police. And I think that's something that needs to be taught not only in the schools, but parents need to show their children that the police need to be respected, and they need to allow them, the police to respect them. It goes both ways. The SROs in the schools, I believe, are a benefit. My youngest daughter, when this all came out about defunding the police, she wrote a letter to the paper about how she felt about that. Being in school, she's out of school now, but if she would have been in school without SROs, she felt she would have been very uncomfortable, because there were things that went on that they took care of. And so, just that was just something that was personal to me. And I'm happy that the police are here, that they do a good job, and I've seen it firsthand.
Thank you. I do have the benefit of having seen this firsthand, being in the school, and it's kind of unfortunate that we need to make this decision as a district-wide, because certainly the position of SRO has the potential to be abused and to be toxic. But from everything that I've seen at McNary with Officer Zavala, who is the SRO there, it's a very positive relationship for the most part. I have not ever heard any negatives about Officer Zavala. And the relationships that he builds with those kids are really important. So in the current situation, if a kid gets in trouble with the law, their first experience is with Officer Zavala, who builds that relationship and kind of helps them see, where this is going and so forth. Whereas if we don't have the SRO in the school to build that relationship, then they're just going to be confronted with some other law enforcement official that they don't know, and that's going to probably escalate. So it's all about the relationships. And again, I see how this position could be abused, but from what I'm seeing, that is the greatest benefit. Furthermore, as a resource, Dan Morrison is our assistant principal in charge of discipline. And he worked very carefully with Officer Zavala to, again, build those relationships. The goal is to keep those kids in school. The goal is to help those kids make better choices, and that takes relationships. So I've seen that work. I myself have gone in to talk to Officer Zavala about the effects of the legalization of marijuana and the effect that that has had on the kids, and he helped me be able to understand that perspective. And so he is a really excellent resource with that. In general, I think our police department is fabulous. I had the opportunity to be part of the first Citizens Police Academy, and that was a wonderful opportunity. What that was is basically a citizens outreach. It was very targeted for members of the community to come in and help understand the police. So it started with their philosophy, and then it went through what each of the departments do, and we even got to do some simulation training, which was fascinating. And we did a tour of the jail, and it was just really interesting and enlightening. And I just came out of that with a really healthy respect for our police department. Furthermore, they do things like blast camp. They have their soccer days of the park. They are a real presence in the community. And I think that presence, again, builds those relationships, because that's what's going to build the respect and trust between the police and the citizens. As far as changing things in the police department, I think Chief Keith would be the first one to say that it's critical to continue to evolve as our needs do. And he has been really, under his leadership, things have changed and evolved. And I really respect that about our police, and I'm very proud of them.
Thank you.
Councilor Reed. Now, since you would be answering the next question, again, we will hear from Mayor Kathy Thorne.
Thank you so much. These have been fabulous answers, and I've really enjoyed hearing everybody's perspective. A couple of things. When we instituted the police fee, we asked the chief not just how many bodies do you need, but what functions do you need to accomplish in achieving public safety for the people of Kaiser. That was very important that we understand what our police are doing and how they are doing it. Councilor Reed is right that our police department continues to evolve and change and adapt to the needs of the community for providing public safety. In addition, we were able to add code enforcement, which has freed up some of our police activity or calls for service, but has also added a layer of service to the people in our community, taking care of those neighborhood things, you know, from tall grassy weeds to abandoned houses to camps and so forth. Again, adding another layer of public safety to our community, and if we can get another one of those, that would be awesome, because we keep our one very, very busy. So the police department does continue to evolve and grow, and Chief Teague said it, that their purpose, their objective is justice. So it's not how many tickets do you write, it's not how many of this or that, but it's how are we helping to educate, inform, enforce, encourage, so that we can live in community together safely. On the school resource officers, that is a contract with the Salem-Kaiser School District. So while we have officers here who are trained, who go through the extra efforts to become school resource officers with that very special and specialized training and relationship building with our youth so they can be effective, if the school district hasn't signed a contract or opened, I mean, right now we could have all contracts all day long, they're just not going to be there. That is really the school district's call. Will our officers be ready to do that job? Absolutely. Will they be there to assist our students? You bet. And they are there for the benefit of the students, for their safety. We also have officers who specialize in the layout and safety around the school. So looking at how are the doors and other access points for the safety for the students and staff. And that in the past has paid off big time. So that's my answer.
Thank you, Mayor Clark. Now I would like to remind you that if you have questions that you would like to have answered, if you haven't written them down already, raise your hand. Oh, these are ones that are...
Those are ones, yeah.
Okay, so does anybody have any of those that you want me to pick up? Thank you. And the next question was, since I'm over here, are you ready for this? If you are elected, what would you bring to the council? That was kind of interesting because you're already on the council. So, what would you continue to bring to the council in your instance?
Well, thank you. So, on the council, one of the things that I have brought to this is my ability to listen and to ask deep and probing questions. We have, again, as I mentioned, we have a variety of people with a variety of personal and professional perspectives. And being part of that team, it's really important to be able to draw out that information. A lot of the decisions that the city makes are highly technical. I'm on the Stormwater Advisory Committee, for instance. Who knew that that was definitely the most technical committee that I've been on in the city? And it's all kind of, there was a steep learning curve with that. And yet to be able to join that group and to be able to come to understand it, I have a whole list of acronyms that I bring to every meeting that I refer to very carefully. But that's being able to ask the right questions helps people come to understanding. Helps me come to an understanding, but also helps other people come to an understanding of just the variety of perspectives that might be available. tried to do and will do more of is support the not only the city efforts, but also the community efforts in supporting the youth. We have a wonderful Kaiser community to support our youth. You just go to a McNary football game, not this season, unfortunately, but generally speaking, the stands are full of not just McNary parents, not just students, but a whole community. And we see that with all kinds of McNary events. But not only that, there are also the private schools and the homeschool communities, and those people are also important parts of our community. And I am going to make even further efforts to make sure to get our youth involved. I've even this year in our distance format, I have one girl who's applied for to be the youth liaison for the Arts Commission. So I'm uniquely positioned to do that, and I'm excited to get the youth involved because they are the next generation of decision makers. So just my ability to work as a team and to listen and to ask the tough questions are some things that I have brought to the council, and again, my relationship with the school, I think that's really it's informed a lot of my thinking, for sure, and the thinking that I bring to the council, and I think that's an important bridge. Thank you.
What I hope to bring to the city council is my experience as a small businessman. My business has been here in Kaiser for 17 years. I've lived here for 24 years, and I know how Kaiser feels to me. And when I talk to different people about Kaiser, I can usually get that across. But to how everybody here in Kaiser enjoys the small town feel. We're right next to Salem, so we have everything we need there. But the community we have here just is awesome. We've got everybody just pitches in and helps, and I hope to keep that moving forward. I don't think that's very hard to do because there are so many people that feel the same way that I do. But my experience with the Kaiser Chamber and being able to work with the city council and the city staff and all the things that we partner with, I think will help be a benefit to keep that moving on. My experience on the Planning Commission, I believe, will be a help with the future growth that we're expecting. And we know we have to work towards making that happen and making things comfortable for the new citizens coming in. I've been on the Home Builders Association Board of Directors, and I understand the housing needs and what the economics of that is. That's a big thing that's going to definitely be a part of the upcoming growth equation, is how to make things affordable. But I hope to bring my experience with that and do the best I can to help move things forward and keep Kaiser feeling like Kaiser.
So, if elected to council, what I will bring is a diversity of life experiences. I've lived in many different parts of the United States, urban part, rural part, conservative and liberal, and it's allowed me to talk to people of all different beliefs and backgrounds. And it's also given me the skills of listening to those people because they have their own life experiences that they want someone to hear, and that's how it informs their views. I've seen what works in communities all over the country, the decisions that are made by those community leaders, and why some cities are more successful than others. So I've seen, and it's helped inform me in my view of how we can make Kaiser an even better community. I've got a natural resources background, as I said, and one of the things that I've seen and learned in natural resources is an ecosystem is healthiest when it's I have had experience on committees, the planning commission, the traffic safety, bike ways and pedestrian committee. I've also been on, I am on the Seattle Advisory Transit Budget Committee. And finally, the generational. I'm Gen X. We're not as young as we used to be. But, you know, it is a different voice. People call this cynical, but I think we were just growing up realists. So we have that. I'm certainly not as young as Dylan, but I do have a slightly younger voice to the council. So, thank you.
I really appreciate these set of questions this evening. It's making us think a little bit differently, so thank you. I really appreciate it. You know, as someone who grew up in a small town, that's one of the things that I like about Kaiser is the small town feel here, and certainly raising my family here, having that investment in the city is one of the reasons why I'm running for Kaiser City Council. In terms of what I would bring, I have had the opportunity over the last 20 years to dip my toes into lots of different areas in terms of our infrastructure, our various systems, whether it's healthcare, education, or criminal justice system, advocacy, whatever it might be, and learn from all of those different systems and all of those different perspectives. And navigate really difficult conversations for the benefit of the whatever community that we're living in, or whatever community those institutions or those systems touch. And I have learned a lot about how to be in the hot seat, and myself have made mistakes, and wanting to be accountable for those mistakes. So really having the humility to kind of listen when things are not great, but also like building on the strengths that we have in those moments to make things better. And that is something that I want to bring to the Kaiser City Council. Just a reminder to myself and every situation I've been in that it's not about me, it's about us as a whole. And how do we, see the humanity in each other? How do we acknowledge what our strengths and our weaknesses are, and how collectively we can come to consensus with civility and move forward? So I think that is something that I would bring to the Kaiser City Council. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. I have a lot of education, and I have the student loans to prove it. What my many of the letters after my name taught me is that if I put my mind to something, I can get it done. I know I will bring experience and wisdom to the board, to the city council, pardon me. I currently represent a number of small businesses. I understand the issues that they're facing these days. Like I said earlier, I represent a number of special needs families, and I understand the trials that they go through on a daily basis. I also, have learned from my past mistakes, which some people have brought up in the past. And what that taught me is that not everybody is perfect. And so what I'll bring to city council is that humility, that compassion, that understanding that not only my fellow city councilors, but the wonderful people that work for the city of Kaiser, as well as the people that come before the city council, are doing their best. I'll bring that humility, that compassion, and that understanding, which I think is something that is desperately needed in public life these days. My job is to solve problems. That's what I do as a lawyer. I bring people together, and I try to move the ball forward. And when it's necessary, I advocate on behalf of my client. Those are the skills that I've developed over the last 20 years that I will bring to the city council. As a practical matter, I will bring my unique skill set
I saw some of you doing the math earlier when I said I graduated in 2009. That sounds right, I just don't say things. It's funny. And so I'm 29, and I like to get out in front of it and let you know, I realize I'm a little young, I think, for this kind of service. I don't think I'm a little young. Some people may perceive that I am a little young. When you look at me without a mask on, you might think I've got a bit of a baby face. But I think that certainly is something to be concerned about. With age comes wisdom, and typically the people who are in government positions are a little bit older than me. And I've got, in lieu of that, great mentors that I can lean on all throughout different aspects of my life. People I've worked with on the Parks Board, people I work with in my job, my family who is in this room. I've got lots of people I can lean on in lieu of that. But in addition, I believe that being young as I am allows me to bring a fresh perspective that you don't often see in areas of government like this. And I'm really excited to be able to exercise that and bring that fresh perspective to our city. Going ahead, I think we all now have a greater understanding of the ways that technology is going to have an impact in our daily lives. Maybe 8 months ago, you might have been able to go throughout your life without thinking about what talking to someone over the internet would be like. But now most of us can't get around that, at least in an average week. And the future is only going to rely more on that. And I've got a background familiarity in the internet. I grew up there. And it's a familiarity, I think, that will be useful in forging a path forward for Kaiser. We need to not only think about how we're going to grow physically, but we also need to think about how we're going to grow technologically to support the new jobs of the future and the new ways that we access all of the things we need in our lives. And that will happen through new means of technology. I believe that I've got a responsibility to my community and my family and myself. And this is a great way to serve all of those, to bring what I've built myself so far as a human to my community in a really powerful way. So thank you for having me.
You are part of the community already, of mayorship. You are the Energizer Bunny. She's everywhere. If I told you all the things that I know that she's done the last 2 days, you'd go, are you kidding me? She would probably say it too. I can't believe I did it. So, I have a question for you. Question is, no, I can't have that one. Sorry. This is a question for her, and then I'll ask everyone else a question. Home values, since we can't make more land, how can the council create ways for Kaiser to be known as the, let me say it again, maybe better eyes. Since we can't make more land, how can the council create ways for Kaiser to be known as the lowest tax rate in the county and still be able to have places for people to live affordably? What can the council do to promote more high-density housing? I like the look.
There's about four questions in there. Yeah. So I'm going to break this down a little bit. Home values, they're market driven. Kaiser is a highly desirable zip code. We have access to I-5. We have a warm community that people want to be a part of. We have access to shopping and other amenities and natural resources that are very desirable as well. On top of that, as people are seeking to have places that can be a home rather than a repository for your stuff when you run off to work, we are also a place that people already done our housing needs analysis. We know where infill can occur, but that is, of course, up to the property owner. There are some people who like their wingspan or their social distancing, and so it's up to the property owners to turn that over. We've already done the work through the Planning Commission. They did detailed work for Planning Department and then the Council on redoing our infill requirements to make it easier for people to go ahead and do infill, add accessory dwelling units, cottage clusters, duplexes, or to redevelop a property with multiple houses on it. What does that feel like? I know, because that's my neighborhood you're talking about. That happened to the lot right back of my house. It went from one home to an additional home plus an accessory dwelling unit, or what they call ADU. So I'm living in that. I know what it's like. It's a little more crowded, but it allows for more opportunity for people to have homes. Lowest tax rate in, actually with the lowest tax rate of any full service city in Oregon at 208 per thousand. That was set because of measures 547 and 50. That is our tax base, and until the Constitution of Oregon changes, that will continue to be our tax base. We can add on to that if the voters of Kaiser so choose. In the meantime, that's why we have a police fee and a parks fee to bolster those two very important functions of the city.
Okay, that's enough.
Good. All right. There was one more piece, but stay tuned.
I was watching for the little tiny thing.
Well, we give you a little more latitude.
Now,
one of the things that you guys are probably I noticed that there were some people taking notes. It's like, oh, this is what I would say about this one. Guess what? You don't get to answer that question. So this is a question that you do get to answer, though. In Kaiser, we lack any industrial area. Is this something that we should have a plan to change? And if so, why? Or not?
You know, I think that we, there's a couple of different views on that, I guess. I would be willing to listen to people on this, because I don't know. And I'm not afraid to say that I don't know, because I want to learn and hear what other people have to say. My shot in the dark, I guess, at this is that there's kind of a trade-off that we already have, you know, the mayor just acknowledged that one of the reasons that Kaiser is desirable is that you can get out of it pretty quickly if you need to, and go to a place where there is industrial options for primarily jobs, I believe, would be the main desire there. But I don't believe it would necessarily be a bad thing to have that. We've got limited options there, so when we're talking about growth, it's going to be a trade-off of, are we going to put more houses in here, or are we going to put more industrial zoning in here? And I don't know what the right answer is. I'm sure that most people would just want more neighborhoods and more houses, but it's a bit of a trade-off. So I don't know the right answer, and maybe there isn't an exact right answer, but I think that I'm willing to listen and hear what other people have to say to come to the right conclusion.
This is where my experience as a land use attorney is going to benefit the city council, because there is one. The right answer is yes, we have to add more industrial land, because state law requires every municipality to have a 20-year, every urban, to have a 20-year land supply of all different types of land, including industrial. We fall well short of what our 20-year land supply is. So will we have to, if we fortunate enough to be able to expand the urban growth boundaries, so on and so forth, are we going to have to plan for some of that to be industrial land? Absolutely. But industrial land, you know, we all think about it in terms of heavy machinery and those sorts of things, and, you know, batch plants and whatever else. That's not what necessarily industrial land entails. It can also entail, for instance, high tech, again, biotech, nanotech, those sorts of things as well. So when we hopefully expand our urban growth boundary, the answer is yes, we're going to need to include at least some industrial land. And when we make that plan, and when we do that, I think what we should be planning for said, like high-tech, nanotech, the biomedical, those sorts of things. So so the answer to the question is, do we need more? Yes, we do need more. And frankly, DLCD, Department of Land Conservation Development, is going to make us, if we are fortunate enough to expand our urban growth boundary, we're going to make sure that we include more industrial.
Thank you. So I don't necessarily have a particular agenda around this question. I do think, I appreciate the study that was done, the conversations that have been had, particularly around our urban growth boundary, and what that might look like moving forward. And I think it's exciting to think about what kind of enterprise we might be able to bring to the area to promote more jobs for our residents here. I also want to weigh that with the, you know, desire to, you know, protect and value the beautiful farmland that we have to the north of us. So I think it's a conversation that we want to be smart about in terms of what Kaiser does moving forward. And so for me, I want to hear what the options are. I want to hear what residents, particularly to the north, the northern part of Kaiser, because it's going to impact those residents the most if we're looking at growing to the north. And so the short answer is, I want more information, I want to hear from residents, and I want to have options in front of us so that we can make the right decision for our community.
I would say, yes, we should do something about the lack of industrial land. It's been shown many times how so many people in Kaiser have to leave Kaiser to work. And every time you're spending away from your home is the time you spend away from your family. Although these days people might want that. But you know, part of it is being more efficient with the land, and as we use our land more efficiently, then that allow us to be more creative as to where industrial land is. But like Ross was saying, you know, we have to be creative on what we think of as the industry. You know, it's not these giant multi-acre factories. It doesn't have to be just that. It can be small-scale entrepreneurial industry. And with that, that means we need to have adaptable buildings, adaptable spaces, and spaces that have a low entry cost for hopefully Kaiser-born or living entrepreneurs who feel like, hey, I've got this great idea. There's this place here I can rent, and I can work on my idea. And then if I outgrow it, hopefully there'll be more room in Kaiser for me. But at least we know we have a people who feel comfortable starting businesses here. Right now, as far as I know, the only industrial land we have is up by the waste treatment facility, so that is a bit of a problem just for transportation. So that's why I really look at Kaiser Station as a lost opportunity, being right next to the highway and rail. That could have been a good or large scale industrial land. Thank you.
So we, you know, there's ways to grow that really isn't going to take up prime farmland. And with the railroad running through there, that is a prime opportunity to allow for industrial expansion.
Thank you. I think this issue really highlights what one of the things that Kaiser does really well, and that is partner with our community, other community entities. I'm going to bring up SITECOR and then promptly forget what it stands for, but it has to do with strategic economic development, and Kathy is on that board, and you know, bringing business into Kaiser is not something that the city has a whole lot of direct control over. Yes, we can set the atmosphere, but it's working with our community partners that will really bring that vibrant the vibrant business community, the incoming businesses. So I think we need to continue to work with our regional partners on that, and growth is easier in terms of industrial rather than residential, and so we need to be able to, again, listen carefully, watch for our opportunities, and make smart decisions based on how we want Kaiser to grow. And again, that's no one person's decision. It's not even the council's decision. It is the city's input that we really rely on in order to make those decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Sorry, you don't get to answer that one. So now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls of all ages, we have the exciting lightning round coming up. In my little packet here, there are six questions. Each councilor will have an opportunity to select one of these questions, and they will have 90 seconds to answer it. Then we will move on to the next question. Councilor Reed, you are the first contestant on the questions right.
Sessions, and so I've learned a lot about this, and it is really important because we as a council represent everybody, and we need to be able to go out and find out what people need, and so that outreach is really critical, and defining some of the problems, because there are many people in Kaiser that says we don't have a racial problem, and well, anybody of any kind of racial background will tell you that is not true. So, and again, from my perspective at the school, it is really important for those kids to feel safe, for those kids to feel part of the community. And it's an ongoing process because there are things that we can do as a government, and then there are things we can do to promote interpersonal relations, but there's nothing we can do to mandate this. But there is a great deal that we can do. And I am proud of our efforts. This is very difficult work, and it is, there are tough conversations sometimes, and again, it requires listening to people's stories. It requires being able to not only put forth the words, but also the actions behind that. And so, again, I realize that what I'm talking about right now is fairly vague, but it's a very complicated problem, and so we need to be able to approach it in a respectful manner.
Councilor Reed. Hi. Pick your poison.
How much did I win?
We have to tally it all up. We'll know on November 3rd. Are you ready?
Do you acknowledge an economic or social divide within and among the residents of Kaiser? If so, does this division need to be addressed? If so, how? I believe there is an economic and social divide in Kaiser, but I don't believe it's near what the national problem is. I believe Kaiser does a pretty good job overall with accepting and allowing start in the home. I believe parents need to teach that, that respect, and how to be kind to your neighbor. That's my answer.
Thank you, Kyle. Michael, you are the next contestant on The Question is Right.
How would I stop a world peace? How have you supported Kaiser Youth in the past, and how do you see that evolving in the future? Well, as I said, I have two young children, both going to Webster Elementary, and when they were younger, I was a soccer coach for my daughter for several years, and currently, and in the hiatus until it starts up again, I was assistant coach for my son. So I tried to be involved with their athletic activities. My wife is a teacher at McNary, so I can hear stories about the struggles that Kaiser has used in the greater Salem-Kaiser school district, the ones that go there, the experience, the problems, and the struggles, as well as the successes. So hearing that, and actually, in a way, not seeing the person, it allows me to make just hear the struggles that they have and try and just focus on solution rather than just focusing on an individual. So looking at what do we need to do to help youth in our entire community.
Besides growth, urban growth boundary, etc., what is Kaiser's greatest challenge going forward? You know, I think we are at a moment in our culture and our communities where we're having really difficult conversations about issues of equity and inclusion, and those are really tough and very difficult conversations. Because it requires each of us to acknowledge our own biases. It acknowledges us, each of us, to acknowledge our own privileges. And that's difficult. There's a lot of emotion that we're all experiencing right now. No matter where we are in the city, and no matter where we are in our communities. And so I think being able to meet those conversations and meet those challenges with accountability, with humility, and taking the opportunity, as I said before, I've made a lot of mistakes. And being willing and open to hear what those mistakes are and how I myself can do better and show up for my neighbor, show up for, my neighbor's kids. I think those are the ways that we show up to those conversations, is by being showing our own humanity, our own humility, and just being accountable for one another.
City's center corner of River Road and Schmaller. Should we add them in other languages? That is a great question. And I think yes, 100%. There was a lady who presented an idea to City Council a while back about the peace poles. And I believe it said peace. It had a couple other messages on them. And the idea was, what language are we going to put on it? And I think somebody, one of the councilors, I think it was Councilor Freeman, said, well, all of them, right? I mean, we were talking about inclusivity and inclusion and all those other things. All of them. maybe if Councilor, or if Mayor Clark wants that. But I think that is a fantastic idea. I think that, I mean, if we want to, you know, it's one thing to talk about passing a resolution and talking about inclusion, and, you know, that's just words. But doing something like that is action. It actually shows that we really, there's something behind what we're saying. So I think that's a great idea, and I would 100% support that. Which one am I going to pick?
You can always say,
can I pick Mike's question? I would like to answer that one.
It's about what we've done for the youth community.
Oh, right.
Our police chief lives in Corvallis. Portland is discussing, as a commission, to require police officers to live in the city. What is your opinion on having officers live in Kaiser? Whoa. Can I get Mike's?
He does not live in Corvallis. No.
That's not I'm just reading the question.
Dylan, why do you lie about
this? I'm sorry. There's only so much I guess I can answer the second part of the question, which is, what is your opinion on having officers live in Kaiser? And I certainly think that that is preferable. I don't know that 100% of the time police have to live in Kaiser or in our own city. But I would certainly love for most of our police officers to come from our own city. I think there's plenty of reasons that our police officers might live in nearby surrounding cities that are valid. Maybe they grew up here, but their family lives in Silverton or Salem or whatever for work or for better access to something they need. And that's reasonable. But having ties to our city is really, really important in Kaiser. And if they don't come from Kaiser, they don't live in Kaiser, that's okay. But I want to make sure that that what our police officers do have is a familiarity with our community and work in our community to make sure that they're serving the people that they are around really often. So whether they do or don't isn't as important as that we have officers that are for and around our community all the time.
Thank you, Mayor Clark.
I'm here to serve.
Thank you, candidates. This has been a lot of fun so far. What do you think of the lightning round? Okay, we're at that time that I need to say a couple of things. The Greater Dexter Neighborhood Association, again, is not endorsing any candidate. It's our intent to allow for an open forum for all candidates to introduce themselves to our community. The Greater Dexter Neighborhood Association is monitoring this forum. The City of Kaiser, the employees, officer, and agents have no connection with the forum. Any concerns with the conduct rules or how we put all this together should be directed to the Greater Dexter Neighborhood Association. Is that okay, Counselor?
And by counselor, you mean
attorney. Counselor. So, we now have 1 minute for each candidate to visit a little bit. And Dylan, you went first on that before, so we're going to start at the other end after Mayor Clark. But the question that I'd like you to consider in your 1 minute summary is, why did you decide to run for mayor or city council, and why should the electorate cast their vote for you, Mayor Clark?
Thank you very much. It has truly been a privilege and an honor to serve this community as mayor for now my 6th year, and I'm looking forward to serving for an additional 2-year term to continue to lead this council as we move forward with difficult and productive community conversations, continuing to make Kaiser the welcoming and vibrant city that we know it is, and leading the way into a future through all of the 2020, well, what the heck, into a future that is going to be successful and vibrant for all of us. I would appreciate your vote and your support, not only for myself, but also for our entire city council, so that we can continue to serve as volunteers for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, again, we have 1 minute for this, and so I'm just going to watch
and you love those you serve. And I really love the peasant community, and that is what prompted me to run for this office in the first place back 4 years ago, and it's also prompting me to run again this time. And the more I know of Kaiser, the more I have come to love it even more and understand the inner workings of it and understand the role that I can play in it. So it's very important to me to contribute. I show up to all the Civic Center cleanups and to all the park, most of the park cleanups, and it's a community effort. And I love the sense of community, and I will continue to perpetuate the sense of community. I really respect the foundation that Kaiser's been built on, and I intend to continue to build on that foundation for a better Kaiser for the future.
Well, thank you. I decided to run for city council because I didn't see people that had the views that I did, running. So I wanted to make sure that I had input, or somebody had input that I liked. So I guess since I like myself, I decided to do it. So that's really it. I just decided I needed to run. Somebody needed to do it, and I decided to step up. I really enjoy being from Kaiser, living in Kaiser, and I just want Kaiser to stay the way it's been for the time that Kaiser's been here, which is definitely short compared to everybody else in the state. So I just thank you for letting me have this opportunity.
First, I'd like to say thank you again to Greater Gubster Neighborhood Association. This has been a really good and fun forum. So I'm running for several reasons. One, I want to move Kaiser forward and make it a city welcoming people of all types, even different ideologies. I don't want to see one ideology dominate the city. That we see that happens a lot of places. I want to see better council representation, both by age and also spreading council representation throughout the city. I want to help work on getting more affordable housing, and I want to make sure that our streets are safer. And finally, nod to Jane, I want to get a library in our town. So thank you, and go to DeBlasi, number 4, betterkaiser.com. Thank you.
Thank you, and yes, thank you again for hosting the candidate forum this evening. It has been a lot of fun. I really appreciate all the questions. So one of the reasons that I'm running is that this is a town that I see demonstrates on a regular basis showing up for each other. I've seen that in my experience as a volunteer in my kids' school, the way the small businesses help us with fundraisers. I've seen it in my work as a nonprofit leader with our faith communities who work really hard to make sure that our residents have the opportunity to put food on the table or that kids have what they need when they want to go to summer camp. I want to show up for this community. I want to show up for this community with the challenges that we have ahead of us in the post-COVID-19 wildfire world, talking about our urban growth boundaries. I believe I have the demonstrated experience of bringing diverse perspectives and points of view to help us meet some of the difficult, challenging conversations that we have ahead of us. And for that reason, I ask for your vote. Thank you.
I'm running to represent you on the Kaiser City Council because I am very passionate about our community, about our unique neighborhood. I can't think of a better place to raise a family, and I'm committed to make sure that we have a great future ahead. You have my word as a father, a husband, a small business owner in this community that I'll give your voices, I'll give the citizens a voice in our city's leadership. I'll demand a transparent, efficient local government. I'll support our local businesses, make smart decisions about transportation, housing, and promote balanced development. I love this city. Kaiser's just an amazing place. And I'll do everything I can to see it flourish in the future. I'd appreciate your support this November with your vote. For more information, go to rosscaperkaiser.com. Thank you very much.
All right, well, this year's been wild, and I think somewhere along the line this year, I saw all that's happening around us and thought that, you know, I need to do something about this. If you don't do anything when you feel like you can, then you're kind of responsible for what comes next. And so I thought, oh, this is a position I may be willing and able to bring a lot of experience to, and I would like the chance to represent and blaze a path for future generations to create a safe and welcoming and successful future for Kaiser. Thank you. For more information, go to dylanforkaiser.com.
Thank you, candidates. May I say that it's been a pleasure for me to have an opportunity to help direct the questions and things tonight. It's been a lot of fun. I'd like to thank the Greater Gebser Neighborhood Association for inviting me to do that. Just a couple of things. I am a city councilor. My name is Dan Kohler. I didn't ever say that, but it's interesting to me, and I just wanted to say I applaud each of these candidates for doing their best to help us understand who they are. It takes an awful lot of guts to put yourself out to say, oh yeah, okay, I'll do this. A lot of people put you under the microscope and say, gosh, oh, this guy, this gal, once she had three toes that she had to have amputated. Who cares? But again, thank you. I appreciate your willingness to put yourself out and to be a part of Kaiser. Whether you win or lose, we hope that you always will be a part of Kaiser and continue to volunteer and be a great part. Is there anything I've missed tonight?
No, just thank you everyone for coming. We really appreciate it. Thank you, Dan and Dana.
Thank you.